Good afternoon, we are Boris and Herman, and we are going to present a webinar which is titled Explore the Known Protein Space through a UniProt Archive and Clusters. Basically, we are going to talk about UniPark and UniRef. Let's start. So what is UniPark? UniPark is a comprehensive and non-redundant database which contains most of the publicly available protein sequences in the world. Protein main exist in different source databases and in multiple copies in the same database. UniPark avoids such redundancy by storing each unique sequence only once and gives it a stable and unique identifier, which we call UPI, which means UniPark Protein ID. A UPI is never removed, changed, or reassigned. Currently, UniPark contains 285 million of protein sequences it says 1 billion, but it's approaching 2 billion cross-references. If I go to follow the link, this is how UniPark home webpage looks like. So let's go through UniPark properties in depth with examples. So this example of some protein from a mouse. It exists in several different protein databases. We can see UniProt, Ensemble, RefSeq, PO, Vega, Seed, and in UniPark, they all combined into one entry because the sequence is identical. UniPark has combined many databases into one at the sequence level. Searching UniPark is equivalent to searching many databases simultaneously. Each of those entries is a cross-reference, and database cross-reference links a protein sequence to its original database. So this would go to Ensemble, this would go to UniProt, ENA, Seed, so on. Every time a new cross-reference is created, when we import data from other databases, and when sequence is changed or deleted from a source database, its corresponding cross-reference is marked as deleted. So grayed records indicate that they are inactive at the source. So for example, we see that this sequence in RefSeq was active from 2004 September till 2005 March. And then it was deleted, but the record about it still here. Let's move to the next point, version. If I follow another example, so sequence changes in the source database can be tracked by sequence versions. UniPark does its own internal versioning. Each time a sequence is changed, the internal version of assigned accession is incremented by one. So this is an example of UniProt accession Q9V6L0, which belongs to a fruit fly. During its research in the last 20 years, this protein has changed in sequence several times, and its current version is 3. UniPark detects those changes, and as it is an archive, you can see previous versions of this protein, 1, 2, 3. Every version has its own UPI. So to show how the sequence is changing over time, I can go to columns, select sequence, save, and you can see actual sequence. So basically, it's very similar up to the point, but then scientists do better analysis and to apply some modifications. Our next slide would be result page. So basically, this is a UniPark result page, and you can download all some selected search results in various formats, like FASTA, TAB, delimited, Excel, XML, list, and it can be compressed or uncompressed. In different cases, you can download different type of information. In case of FASTA, you obviously can download only sequence with accessions and status. In case of XML, you download practically everything. You can download XML with its cross references, features, and sequence information. You can also customize columns, as I showed you with the sequence. If we go to individual entry, you can view this entry again in a variety of formats. You can view it as a FASTA, you can view it as a XML, or you can view it as a tab delimited list of accessions. There is a blast button where you can run blast on that sequence. You can customize columns of what information to see. If we scroll down, we can see actual sequence. It has a drop-down box with access to few exposit tools like blast and Carta and ProScale. If we scroll even further, we can see last section of our page, and it shows InterPro features. InterPro is another MBLBI database. It provides functional analysis of proteins by classifying them into families and predicting domains and important sites. To classify protein in this way, InterPro uses predictive models, known as signatures, provided by several different member databases that make up InterPro consortium. If I go to page, you can see the list of member databases at CDD, HAMAP, PFARM, ProScite, SMART, and so on. So on InterPro segment, if we move mouse over, we can see that this particular signature is going from 173 to 289 position on the sequence, and it belongs to this particular domain, and you can follow this to InterPro site, and basically defines functionality of this protein. Now, next slide will be about one of the use cases for UniPark. This is a tricky bit, as I must superficially mention redundant proteomes, which is by itself a very broad topic, which lies far outside of this webinar. However, if you work with proteomes in UniProt, you should know that we only keep proteins for non-redundant proteomes in there. And if you need to get sequences for proteomes which are redundant, you can only find them in UniPark. So if I follow this query, so I this list of proteins for E. coli in UniProt. There are two non-redundant, and those grayed out are redundant. And if we click on one redundant, you can see that it's consists of 4,000 proteins, and because it's redundant, you can only get it in UniPark. So if you start download, it will download this information not from UniProt but from UniProt. In our next slide, forgive me if I go a bit too technical for that, but there is no way around it. All what I have shown before was related to working with UniPark via the browser. However, if you are writing pipelines or want to automate data extraction, you can access UniPark programmatically. We have a protein REST API for that. This is our protein API, and it has UniPark section. This is basically a documentation page generated by Swagger. UniPark section of protein API has 7 entry points designed to search UniPark in a variety of ways. You can search it by UPI, by UPID, which is protein ID, sequence, cross-reference, accession, UniProt accession, and so on. Let's look at one entry point. So this entry point will search UniPark by UniProt accession. It can return results in JSON or XML or Fasten. So if I type the example we used before, which is Q9V6L0, click try it out, I get results in JSON format. If we scroll down, we can see section for cross-references. Then there is a section for features, so this is features, signature sequence match. And finally, there is a section about sequence itself. There are also HTTP response code and HTTP headers. Most useful section here would be a request to sample code. For most popular languages used by bioinformatics community, which you can, and you can use this code to kickstart your programming. This is Perl, for example. So this mainly covers UniPark and what you can do with it. So now we're going to move to our next topic, UniRef. I mean, pass it to Herman.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Herman from UniProt team, and I'm going to introduce you into UniRef database now. So let's go back to the slides. So as we have heard from Boris, UniPark database merges protein sequences with 100% sequence identity over the full length into one entry. This reduces the size of the protein database while still representing all known protein sequences. But not only the exactly same protein sequence has the same function, also similar protein sequences have the same or a similar function. And therefore, UniProt reference clusters, UniRef, cluster together similar protein sequences into the same record. By merging all protein sequences from UniProt KB and selected sequences from UniPark at resolutions of 100, 90, and 50% sequence identity, the UniProt reference clusters UniRef 100, UniRef 90, and respectively UniRef 50 are obtained. For UniRef, sequence identity is measured not over the full sequence length, but like for UniPark, the clustering does not take into account the taxonomy of the protein sequences. Merging similar protein sequences removes sequence bias and redundancy from the database, but still covers the whole known protein sequence space. This can be quite useful, in particular for BLAST searches, which I will demonstrate later in this webinar. Let's first look at the sequence diversity within UniRef clusters at different resolutions. At the top of this slide, you can see an alignment of the N-terminal part of three protein sequences within one UniRef 100 cluster. In this example, one sequence originates from UniProt KB SwissProt, another one from UniProt KB Tremble, and the third one from UniPark. You can see that for UniRef clusters, the sequence identity is not measured over the full length other than for UniPark database, because here there is an additional part in this one sequence at the N terminus. While all protein sequences in the UniRef 100 cluster have 100% sequence identity, the protein sequences in the corresponding UniRef 90 cluster are a bit more diverse, with a sequence identity larger than 90%. This is visualized in the sequence alignment at the bottom of this slide, which contains some selected sequences from the UniRef 90 cluster of the same protein. And for UniRef 50, the sequence diversity increases even more, And at the same time that we have more diversity and more protein sequences in one cluster, the database size shrinks from UniProc down to UniRef 50, from 285 million records to 38 million records. So this is how UniRef is generated and what it consists of. So let's look at the representation of UniRef on UniProt website. So you, on UniProt website, you have the link to UniRef down here. So you get a similar interface like for UniProt KB and as you've seen before for UniProc. So let's look at an example entry that I've chosen, what that we can search in the generic search, and we will find three corresponding clusters for this example protein, one from UniRef 50, one from UniRef 100, and one from UniRef 90. A cluster contains, beside the cluster ID, a cluster name, which is a generic, which is a protein name common to all the protein members in the cluster. It contains a protein count in the size column, which brings the number of proteins within the cluster. It contains the protein accessions of all members, the corresponding organisms from which these protein accessions are, and it contains the representative sequence length of this cluster. And some clusters, for the clusters where it's possible, it also contains a common taxon, which is shared across all proteins within the cluster. So if we click on the identifier of a cluster, in this case, the UniRef 100 cluster, we get more detailed information about the cluster on the member page. Each cluster has a seed sequence, which is the longest sequence in the cluster. However, the seed sequence is not always the best annotated sequence. So therefore, another sequence like here may be chosen as the representative sequence. The representative sequence is the best annotated sequence, which has the most annotations, the most comments, the most cross-references, and the most information about the function of the protein. Another very useful information on the UniRef website is the advanced search, similar to UniProt or UniProc website. In this advanced search, you can search through the properties of the UniRef clusters that I've shown before. You can search for cluster names. You can search for the taxonomy of the protein member sequences. You can search by sequence identity, which corresponds to searching in UniRef 50, 90, 100, or in any UniRef cluster. You can generate a condition for the size of the cluster, the number of proteins in the cluster, for the sequence length, and for identifiers in the cluster. Let's do an example for this. So if I search, for example, for the cluster of HisF protein, for all which contains bacteria sequences, and I'm only interested in UniRef 50 cluster, so I choose more than 50% sequence identity, then we get as a result 331 UniRef clusters for this protein. So another important use case of UniRef clusters is the BLAST search. Like UniProc database or UniRef cluster, UniRef clusters can be searched through UniProt's BLAST search. I'm going to show you how you can access the BLAST tool. So I'm going back to the main UniProt website. You find down here the link to BLAST. And In the BLAST tool, you need to paste in a protein sequence, and you find here the field where you can choose which database you want to BLAST against. The standard database is the UniProt KB reference proteomes plus SwissProt. And down here, you can also choose UniParc database or one of the UniRef clusters, like UniRef 90 for in this example. So what I need to do, what I need now is a protein sequence. Let's see if I have, I need to search for a protein sequence now. Let's use the identifier from before. All right, and I need it in FASTA format. All right, and then with, I'm just blasting with the standard properties now in UniRef 90 database, and I can start this BLAST search, which will run for some time now. So I don't want you to wait until this BLAST search is finished. I've done this before, and I can show you the results on this browser window. So this is the BLAST result of this protein sequence in UniParc. The top hits in are in this case highly similar. As you see, the second one has 100% sequence identity, and still if you go down up to the 10th hit, you are still at 99% sequence identity, which means these proteins are still highly redundant. Taking into account a further BLAST hit does not add much information to this. It's similar if we search against UniRef 100. So this is the search result against UniRef 100. There we find slightly more sequence diversity among the top hits. So the second one has 99.6% sequence identity. And if we go down to the 10th hit, it has still 97% sequence identity. However, on the next tab here, I have opened the search results against UniRef 90. Here you can see the identity of the second hit is already down at 93%. And if we go further down to the 10th best hit, we have only 60% sequence identity. So, and each of these hits represents a whole cluster of similar protein sequences. Therefore, when searching against UniRef 90, we are covering much more and much more diverse protein sequences just by looking at the first 10 BLAST hits. And an 11th hit will add much more valuable information in UniRef 90 than in a normal protein sequence database. This tendency continues if we look finally at the UniRef 50 search result for the same protein sequences. Here already the second hit has a sequence identity of 68.5%. And if we go down to the 10th hit, we are at 56% sequence identity. So in this case, we cover even more of the protein sequence space just by looking at the top 10 matches. So in this webinar, we have presented UniParc, the comprehensive non-redundant sequence archive, and UniProt reference clusters, UniRef, which cluster the protein sequence space at different resolutions of sequence identity. We hope we could introduce you to the advantages of these concepts and hope it will be useful for your research. And now we are happy to take any questions. So the question is, so UniRef 100 includes overhang. Has this a his tag on it? Yes, I've actually looked at this example. So this protein sequence is coming from UniParc, and it is coming in UniParc from PDB, And there it is a structure that has an N-terminal tag, which is probably a his tag, so an affinity tag for the purification. And so it is basically the same protein sequence, but in UniProc database, it has not been merged into the same UPI because it has this N-terminal tag. So the sequence is identical 100%, but not over the full length. So the question here is, here the size of cluster 50 is more than the size of cluster 100, yes. Then how is it that the cluster size shrinks from cluster 100 to cluster 50? Isn't that contradictory? So it's not contradictory because in UniRef 100, the criterion is that all proteins in the cluster must have 100% sequence identity, which is the most restrictive criterion. For UniRef 50, the criterion is the proteins must have more than 50% sequence identity, which is more relaxed than 100%. So more proteins are clustered into the same cluster for UniRef 50 than for UniRef 100. So the question is there relation with cluster and protein-protein interaction database? So from you need in order to get to a protein-protein interactions database, you need to go through UniProt KB. So UniPark has cross references to UniProt KB, and inside UniProt KB you can find cross references to many other protein databases like interaction databases, and yeah, maybe not sure what is meant with cluster, but there are cross references to lots of other databases which are more specific for other topics related to proteins.
Thank you. So we'll leave it there for today. Thank you again to both Boris and Herman, and thank you to everyone who's listened.